very pleased to have Professor Tommaso Poggio from MIT. Professor Poggio got his doctorate in theoretical physics in 1971 in Genoa. After that, he was at the Max Planck Institute from 1972 to 1981. And since then, he has been a professor in the Department of Brain and Cognitive Sciences at MIT. So let's welcome Professor Poggio.
Thanks a lot. Good to be here. I'll speak about some attempts to develop a theory for deep learning. There is no question that deep learning is a big story, for instance, in Asia, much bigger there than Donald Trump. I was in Seoul a couple of months ago when AlphaGo won against Lee Sedo, who is the guy, let's see, is this one? The world, unofficially the world champion of Go. And it was a real circus with many TV crews and people staying up looking at the games as if they were the World Cup final of soccer. Pretty amazing. And this is from an article in the Financial Times. Is Demis Hassabis, who is the CEO of DeepMind. And I'm mentioning him because he was, for a short time, a postdoc of mine. And the most interesting thing is that he's a neuroscientist in charge of what arguably is one of the leading companies in the field of artificial intelligence today. And this is because I want to make the point that recent advances in the engineering of intelligence, and AlphaGo is one example. The other example, which I think is even better, is system to drive or help drive autonomously or semi-autonomously cars, like the system in the Tesla and similar systems in many other cars. This comes from a company in Jerusalem called Mobileye, which was started by another postdoc of mine, Amnon Shashua. That's a real life task which has very little room for errors, you know, driving a car. And deep learning is also used there. So it's interesting that all of these advances were started by physiology work back in the 60s at Harvard by Hubel and Wiesel, recording from neurons in primary visual cortex. This is a part of cortex which is back of your head, where visual processing starts after information comes there from the eyes through the LGN. And then there were a number of models, the most interesting one, Fukushima, that had this kind of hierarchical layer architectures with simple and complex cells and pooling between simple and complex cells. And the architecture is basically exactly the same as it is used in neural networks in the 90s, like LeNet, and more recently in deep convolutional networks. The learning techniques is different. It's not stochastic gradient descent, but the architecture is basically the same, comes from these ideas of Hubel and Wiesel. And this kind of models work in real life and also in terms of how well they imitate what happens in primate cortex. Let's see if I can get. You see up there, for instance, a series of images. You have to say whether there is an animal or not. And a network like this one performs essentially at the same level as humans do in a task in which you present so rapidly the images that people cannot move their eyes, so they are forced to use visual cortex in a feed-forward way. This was old work, almost 20 years ago. More recently, there is work by in the lab of Jim DiCarlo in my department, and Danny Amins, who is now at Stanford, in which they analyzed neurons in V4 and IT in monkeys doing various visual tasks, and found a pretty good agreement with units in a deep learning network. the agreements. This data show essentially that you can get, by optimizing performance on the network, you get better and better agreements with the tuning properties of neurons in the visual cortex. I don't get into the details. This is just to say that deep learning networks not only are performing well, these are some of the graphs representing AlexNet and some of the other deep learning networks. They are not only performing well in practical applications like AlphaGo or Mobileye, but also, surprisingly, rather good models of what happens in visual cortex. They seem to be. I'm not a believer yet on this last part, but I'm very intrigued. So there are at least two questions. There are many more about deep networks. But from the theory point of view, one has to do with the representational power of many layers networks. Why are they better than shallow networks? And the second question is, why does stochastic gradient descent work so unreasonably well? After all, it's an optimization problem with millions of variables. I will not address the second question. I'll address only the first one. And let me set the stage. The stage is that we have shallow networks here, a network with 8 variables, one layer, quite a few units. This symbol is a node, including several units, is what in a function approximation theory is called a ridge function, is the linear combination of some nonlinear transformation like the rectifier of dot products of the input with a set of vectors, plus possibly biases. So this is a one-layer network, and this is a particular deep learning network with 2 layers, 3 if you count the output, 3 layers. It's in the form of a binary tree. Now, it is well known since the 80s that one-layer networks are sufficient to approximate arbitrarily well any continuous function from the input to the output on a compact domain. These are all the results, basically Weierstrass theorem in some form or another. And so, in a sense, this was why people, at least theoretically inclined, never considered very much after the 80s multi-layer networks, because it looked like networks with one hidden layer were enough to provide approximation, representations, approximated representation of any mapping, any algorithm going from input to output. And this is, in fact, why after the initial enthusiasm of 20 years or 30 years ago about neural networks, regularization techniques like support vector machines took over, because for those there is a nice theory based on reproducing kernel Hilbert space and convex optimization and bounds on generalization and so on. So this is kind of the typical shallow networks for which we have good theory and good results in practice, but not as good as today's deep learning. Let me just make the point that all these support vector machines, regularization, radial basis functions are shallow networks in our terminology, right? The centers, the hidden layer, correspond to so-called centers, say, of a radial basis function, for instance, or a dot product or another kernel. There are as many centers as data, and then a linear combination of their activities. Now, here is one characterization of when deep learning may be better than shallow networks. And so the previous result says, in general, you can approximate any functions with both shallow and deep. So the difference must be that for some classes of functions, or maybe for many classes of functions, deep learning requires less parameters or has a smaller VC dimension. And so the kind of theorem that is kind of intuitive is that if I have functions which have a specific compositional structure, so this is a function of 8 variables, which is made up of functions of 2 variables. So in a sense, it's really the same structure as this tree. Suppose you have a processor in each one of these nodes that is just taking 2 inputs, each one of these processors. And so this tree will compute a function of 8 variables, but using sub-functions, components, each one of 2 variables. So it's kind of intuitive that if you have a function with this structure, a network with this architecture, where the units here, as I said, these nodes are rich function, so they contain several units, and I'm using the rectifier here. I could use some other nonlinearity. By the way, in the previous result, I want to stress that for shallow network, essentially any nonlinear function here is allowed. The only limitation is should not be a polynomial, but this constraint drops away in the case of deep learning. So for instance, it could be a square in the case of deep learning. So here I'm taking the linear rectifier, but I could take a sigmoid. And then the result essentially says that if I want to use, I have a function of 8 variables or more, d variables, and the function has a compositional structure of this form, then to reach the same error in approximation, I need a number of units of weights and biases for the case of the shallow network, which is exponential in the dimensionality, whereas in the case of the deep network is essentially linear in the dimensionality. These spaces, I'm assuming spaces of function that are essentially Sobolev spaces with a certain smoothness R and D in dimensionality, and with a Sobolev norm which is less or equal to 1. And then I can prove that the error, so the accuracy, the epsilon, for the case of the shallow network is a function of the number of parameters n to minus r is the smoothness of the function to be approximated, and is the dimensionality. But in the case of functions that are compositional and in which each of the component has the same smoothness, but now each component has just dimensionality 2, the total dimensionality is of course the same as D, then in this case the accuracy depends, essentially it does not depend on the dimensionality. There is actually a factor D, this is for each one of the. And it's possible to show that these are the best possible estimates. So the proof use essentially a polynomial type of estimate, Jackson type estimate, but there are results from DeVore showing that these are the best possible. We have extension of this results to the case of Gaussian RBF. So you have here the instead of a rectifier, you have a Gaussian function of the distance between a vector of weights and the inputs. And then there are similar results for the shallow case and for the deep case, without getting too details. In this case, for Gaussian function, we can prove the converse theorem. In other words, if you have good approximation by a deep network, then the function has to be of that particular Gaussian form with particular constraint of smoothness. And we don't have these converse results. I think for technical reasons, in the other case, we may be able to get it. There are similar results for VC dimension. Also, the VC dimension will essentially be exponential in the case of the shallow network and quadratic in the case of the deep network. Okay, so that's kind of the main message. It's a simple result that essentially formalizes what has been an intuition for quite a few years in the field of deep learning, which is that if you have compositional functions, you have inputs that consist of objects and parts are objects and so on, then a convolutional deep architecture is good. The idea being that you represent, like in the Hubel and Wiesel case, you represent first small parts, and then you assemble this in objects, and then the objects are in super objects, and so on, layer after layer. For instance, the HMAX model that we developed long ago, I showed in previous slides, we also described them as a sequence of OR and ANDs, and so a kind of disjunction of conjunction, which has this aspect of, you know, compositionality in it. Let me make a couple of, I'm not sure why 4 and 6, but it's 1, 2, 3, 4. let's call it a couple of remarks. So first of all, ResNet are, for people, how many of you know the term ResNet? Very few, okay. The best, as far as I know, until now, the best performing network on data sets like ImageNet and so on is called Residual Networks. It was developed at Microsoft end of last year. And it is a network which may have up to 1,000 layers or so. Probably the optimal version is around 30 or 40. And it has a structure in which, well, I'll kind of show you. Not shown here, but let me go. Okay, this is a diagram of some ResNet. You don't see it easily here, but it has a structure in which it has the same number of inputs and outputs for quite a few layers, and then there is a pooling, and then again layers with the same number of input and outputs, and that pooling and so on. And so there are about 4 stages of pooling, but up to 30, 40, 100 layers. Okay, so the first thing I want to claim is that a binary tree model is a pretty good model of this ResNet. It's a simplified model, but all the results that we have can be, are true for this other version of it, of the type ResNet. First of all, you can look at a binary tree. This is a kind of a comment within the comment. It's a binary tree as subsampling at each stage. And in principle, I'll speak later according to other theoretical results we have. If you want to have invariance to transformations, in this case, translation in X and Y, what you should do is essentially a local average This would be on a 3x3 pixel in terms of image inputs, and then the output can be subsampled. Now, in practice, does not make essentially any difference if you don't do the average and do immediately the subsampling, which is what some of these networks do. The other part, as I said, is that instead of having one layer with a certain number of units, the next layer will be a smaller number of units, half the number. So these rest nets keep the same number of inputs for several inputs and outputs, several layers, and you can show that the same type of estimates, still linear in the dimensionality and so on, hold also in this case, not only in this case. Okay, so you can show that essentially the binary tree model is a good, Bohr atom type model, good simplification of what's going on in these networks. Now, why compositional functions? Okay, let me try to give you an intuition why they're relatively natural in a certain framework. Suppose I tell you I want to have an algorithm that goes from 6 inputs to 1 output, and I want to use this algorithm, say, on images, for instance. And so I would like this algorithm not to change in its form if the image is larger or smaller. I would like to keep the same structure. Images come under different sizes. There is nothing special like about the size. They're always images. So I impose that the structure of the algorithm should be the same. And then I impose that since if I take an image and I move it, it's still an image. You know, there is shift invariance. There is nothing particular about absolute position in an image, and the statistics of images, shift invariance, and so on. I want to impose that my algorithm, for instance, should be the same on the left side or the right side. Does not matter. So if I, without going into the detail, if I define this algorithm like operator from, say, RM, R2M to R1, and I impose this kind of scalability, that the structure does not change for every M, I end up with a structure algorithms operator that have a structure like this, in which a block here is this whole thing goes from R to M to R to M minus 2, and this one goes from R to M minus 2 to R to M minus 4, and so on. And each layer has a block structure, essentially 2 inputs, 1 output for each block, and each block is the same because of shift invariance in each layer. So this is not a proof, it's not a theorem. It's just showing that imposing some relatively natural constraints on the type of algorithm you want, that they are scalable, so they are independent of the size of the image in their structure, and they are shift invariant, you get this kind of structure, which then you can argue, because of our results, like the theorem I showed before, can approximate it very well by a binary tree, a deep network with a structure of a binary tree. That's kind of one motivation why the combination of shift invariance and scalability, which, by the way, is a little bit in the spirit of the renormalization group, but because of this averaging step by step. Um, So there are other more qualitative arguments, kind of reflecting what people in the field have been saying for a while. The fact that images in particular, you can argue other sensory signals like probably speech, require algorithms of this compositional type. For instance, it turns out that as I said, you can think of all of this like representing a scene, and these are objects, and there is no reason why the computation performed on a part of the image should be different from the computation performed on another part of the image. And you may be able to connect this kind of structure to the statistical properties that people have measured on image statistics, which is relatively scale invariant and certainly shift invariant. There may be some argument about clutter. If you want a system that is invariant to the position of an object in terms of the ability to recognizing it, and then you want, then it turns out that if you want invariance to position, you have the problem that any other object is clutter that will destroy this, not the invariance, but the selectivity, essentially destroys the invariance. But if you have a system that has essentially smaller regions, you can cope in a more robust way with the clutter problem. but these are all qualitative arguments. So let me tell you something a little bit separate, but I think interesting, and it's about the convolution and pooling, because we have done quite a bit of work over the last 3 years on a theory of invariance that is more general, but include the pooling of deep learning networks. This will appear as a book from MIT Press soon. And this starts with the observation that if you have a representation that is invariant to some transformation that are naturally occurring, and for images, clearly position, translation, and then scale, and possibly some rotation on the image plane. These are transformations that happens all the time. You'd like recognition to be invariant to those. Suppose I have an oracle that give me a representation of an image that is invariant to those transformations. Then it's intuitive that the complexity of the problem is much reduced. And you can make this explicit. For instance, this is just a demonstration, very simple. We had different cars and planes, airplanes, and we had a simple classifier just looking at pixels. And you show to the classifier one plane, one car during the learning phase, and you want the classifier then to recognize other example. And in the case in which your representation is not invariant to position or scale or rotation, then the performance of the classifier after being trained with one example is 50% is chance. And even if you use 3, 4, 10 pairs of example, is still pretty bad. On the other hand, suppose that you have this oracle that gives you a representation which is already normalized for scale and position and rotation, then from just one example, your classifier is very good. And you can prove some theorem in special cases in which you can show that, for instance, translation invariance will reduce the complexity by this factor here, essentially how many shifts you have, how much the invariance is. So there is a very, there are a lot of possible algorithms to compute invariance, and computer vision has used a number of them. You can find the object, the center of gravity, so to speak, the barycenter of it, normalize for it, and so on. Many of these are not biologically plausible, so I was interested in a biologically plausible algorithm, which turns out to be very similar to the Hubel and Wiesel simple and complex sets. But let me describe the algorithm in an abstract way first, because this tells you also how a system can learn the invariance. Suppose you are a baby in a crib playing with your toys. One of your toys is a toy bicycle, and while playing, you are rotating it. And the only thing that your visual system needs to do at this stage is to record a movie of this. So it records several frames of a bike rotating. And you store this movie forever, okay? Because this will allow you to recognize from a single image other objects independently of how they are rotated. And the way it goes is that if you see a new object first time, this is this fish, in order to get this invariant representation, you do a dot product of this image with each one of the frames you have stored. So you get 8 numbers, and the claim is that if you have seen here the possible rotation of the bike, then these 8 numbers are invariant to the rotation of the fish. You will get the same 8 numbers independently of whether this fish is in this angle or it's vertical. I said the same 8 numbers, but not in the same order. And so this vector, the vector is not invariant, but something like, for instance, the probability distribution, the histogram of these numbers, which does not depend on the order, is invariant. One way to compute the histogram would be something like this. You can think of sigmoid here, could be like a threshold. So it's measuring how many times this number is above threshold. So these quantities are invariant. Here, just to graphically show this, for instance, in this case, it's translation. You can see that you compute the histogram, and you get the red histogram, which remain the same independently of the translation of the fish. In this case, your template, your bike, would have been displaced instead of rotated. And so here, for the cat, is a blue histogram, also independent of position. And as you can see, they are selective in the sense they are different. The cat is different from the fish, and so the two histograms are different from each other. So this is kind of intuitive how this goes, because for every rotation of the fish, there is a corresponding rotation of the bike, which matches in the same way as the fish before being rotated. Right? So it's a proud effect that we have a group, easy to see in the case of a compact group like rotation, but we have extended this to translation and scale, so all affine transformations. And the basic idea is that you have an image of an object, and under a group transformation, like an affine transformation, could be only rotation, could be rotation scale translation, you get other images and you can get a lot of other images. This is what is called an orbit of the group, starting from the initial image I. You can describe the orbit in terms of a probability, and you can use results like Kramer-Wald theorem of representing a multidimensional probability distribution in terms of one-dimensional projections of it. And the basic trick which allow all of this to work in this case is that instead of transforming the image, is the same thing to transform the template, the bike in this case. So in a sense, if you have seen when you are in the crib all possible transformations of one object, you can transfer this transformation to any new object by doing this similarity measure, this dot product. And so let me skip this. We have some results that seem a little bit in the spirit of Johnson-Lindestrauss, in the sense that, although the proof is quite different, you are looking for, you're representing an image in terms of projections through templates. You need more than one if you want to have selectivity in addition to invariance. So you're projecting, but do you want these projections to be invariant to a group? And so, but how many projections do you need? How many templates? How many things do you need to see in the crib? Well, it turns out that if you want to distinguish n different images invariantly to transformations, what you need are at least k templates, like the bike, and this number that goes up as the log of the number of images you want to distinguish. Connection with Hubel and Wiesel is that you can think of this dot product as what simple cells are doing. Simple cells are tuned to something. This is the T. Simple cells, for instance, in different position will be shifts of the tuning. And then their activity will be some threshold or some nonlinear transformation of this dot product. And some mating will be what the complex cells is doing, and this is invariant. Okay, let me skip this. I want to finish. So I want just to make a comment about the fact that you could extend the result I start initially for about compositional functions, like a structure like a binary tree or similar. It does not need to be, of course, a binary tree. But this can be extended to function that can be well approximated by a sparse polynomial. So for instance, here we have two inputs. You have xy, we have polynomial. Here is 2 to the 20. This, in general, if you try to represent it with a shallow network, could be equivalent to try to represent all the monomials of this huge polynomial. But if you represent it as a deep network, this could be represented in terms of just 9 independent parameters, the 9 coefficients here. And so you could have a much more compact representation. And just as an experiment, an example, we took here a much simpler function, which has the same kind of sparsity. Now it's a trigonometric polynomial, and and try how it works with 1 hidden layer, 2 hidden layer, and 3 hidden layers. And this is the test error, and this is the number, for instance, of parameters. So you see that deeper networks work better. And the reason this may be interesting is because there are quite a few results in older results, 20 or 30 years, about Boolean functions. The Boolean functions can be represented by Fourier, have a Fourier representation that is exactly the same as their polynomial representation. And so the results I mentioned just include as special cases some classical results about the fact that, for instance, the parity function of Boolean function cannot be represented efficiently by shallow circuits, but only by deep ones. I'm finishing here. Since Mike Jordan spoke about big data, I'll tell you that I think the next frontier in machine learning is small data. The first phase of machine learning, you can say, it's been, in fact, big data. Right now, supervised learning does better if you have the more data you have. Mobileye is having teams of people in Sri Lanka to label millions of images, as an example. But this is clearly not how children learn. We don't need to show 1 million examples to a child. Yes, this is a car. No, this is not a car, in order to teach what a car is. So I think the next frontier is how to have machines that can learn from a small number of labeled examples, a lot of unlabeled ones. And there are various ways. I don't expect there will be one solution to this, but various ways to do that. Yeah, let me finish here. Thank you.
Time for some questions from the audience.
I'm quite interested in the way that you phrase that deep learning might help understanding the real how brain works or how the real neural network works. But do you have a comment on what does it mean to understand the brain? Or no, I know that's a very big question, but does that mean that we wanted to understand or infer the structure of the neural system in the brain, or how these neurons interact with each other?
Thank you, very good question. First of all, there is this ironic situation right now that people in deep learning are doing the same thing that neurophysiologists have been doing for 50 years. Neurophysiologists trying to understand how, for instance, visual cortex work, recorded from single electrodes, single neurons in the brain. This seems pretty silly thing to do, because you have in the primate visual cortex, you have about 1 billion neurons. So if you record one neuron at a time, or 10, you know, it's pretty difficult to hope to do something with that. But people have been doing this. There have been some insights, some quite useful, like Hubel and Wiese. The ironic thing is that people that are modeling, that are just working with deep learning, are doing the same thing these days. They're recording from units in the models, trying to understand what's going on. And now, when you're doing that, because there is no theory, and at the same time you're using deep learning to try to understand the brain, I think your question is right. What does it mean to understand, right? I think ideally one would like to have a theory of why deep learning works, and then showing that if true, that you know there are strong analogies between the networks and the brain or some parts of the brain, that will give you some level of understanding.
To make the deep learning architecture actually work, a lot of tricks are necessary to actually estimate the function and make them converge. Do you think your theoretical result hold in presence of all the implicit regularization that is applied to these networks through fancy sampling schemes or gradient clamping and all the different stuff that are made?
So what exactly was the question? I missed the two words.
Whether the theoretical results that you derive would still hold in the empirical case of deep networks that actually are not the simple optimization of the function that is written down, but they require a lot of tricks inside. They require a lot of resampling schemes, a lot of implicit engineering techniques to regularize them.
Well, as I said, the result I showed answer in part the first question, not the second one, which is about optimization. And I guess your question is, how important is the second one? You know, for instance, what I show is assuming that you have the best possible optimum, right? It does not, it may be the case that most of what stochastic gradient descent finds are suboptimal points, values, and that those are quite different from the real optimum. It could be. I think there are some interesting implications. I don't have the time to speak about it from this analysis about some of the most successful tricks, like batch normalization, from what I said. I'll not get into it, but several of the tricks that were touted as very important even just 2 years ago turns out not to be so important. So one has to be careful, like dropout or those kind. Yeah.
Okay, let's